गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन. आई एम डॉक्टर उत्सव शाह एंड टूडेज टॉपिक आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट द ऑप्टिक नर्व हेड इवेल्युएशन. बिफोर आई डायरेक्टली जंप टू द ऑप्टिक नर्व हेड इवेल्युएशन, आई वुड लाइक टू गिव अ ब्रीफ अबाउट द ऑप्टिक नर्व. द ऑप्टिक नर्व कंसिस्ट ऑफ अप्रॉक्सिमेटली 1.2 मिलियन एक्सॉन्स दैट अराइजेस फ्रॉम द रेटिनल गैंग्लियन सेल्स एंड हैज फोर पार्ट्स, out of which the intraocular portion is the smallest one and is the only visible portion of the optic nerve as optic disc on the fundus examination. There are four layers of the optic nerve head. The first is the superficial nerve fiber layer. The second is the prelaminar layer. Third is the laminar layer. And fourth is the retrolaminar layer. The arrangement of the nerve fibers. The peripheral fibers in this image, we can see that the peripheral fibers are progressively overlaid by the central fibers. Therefore, the peripheral fibers remain peripheral as they enter the disc, and the central fibers enter centrally adjacent to the physiological cup. In this image, we can see that the red and blue fibers that represents the arcuate nerve fiber, that represent the arcuate nerve fiber, having the longest root and are most susceptible to the glaucomatous damage. While the papillomacular bundle fibers that arises from the macula having the shortest root, and these are the most resistant to the glaucomatous damage, and this explains the retention of central vision till end. Glaucoma is a multifactorial disease, and then the diagnosis is mainly based upon the raised intraocular pressure, which is the risk factor, and the optic nerve head changes and visual field defect. Changes in the optic nerve can be either disc changes or vascular changes or peripapillary changes. Here in this schematic diagram, the number 1 represent the optic cup, the number 2 represent the neuroretinal ring, the number 3 represent the scleral ring, number 4 is the beta zone, and number 5 is the alpha zone, which we will be talking in the subsequent slides. Disc changes, these are the parameters we will be seeing. This is the photograph of the disc with a central area known as cup, and the area between these two cup and disc is known as neuroretinal rim. Optic disc assessment can be either qualitative or quantitative. Qualitative with the help of direct ophthalmoscope, or slit lamp indirect ophthalmoscopy, either with a disc photography or RNFL photography. And quantitative with the help of disc photography with digitalization, stereo disc photography with optic disc analysis, OCT, Heidelberg retinal tomography, and laser polarimetry. Critical steps in assessing the disc, the famously known as 5 R's. The first is to observe the scleral ring to identify the limit of the optic disc and its size. Second is to identify the size of the neuroretinal rim. Third is to examine the retinal nerve fiber layer. Fourth is to examine the region of the peripapillary atrophy and to look for the retinal or optic disc hemorrhages. Coming to the optic disc size, it is important to observe the scleral ring to identify the limits of the optic disc and its size. There are two terms, that is micro disc and macro disc. Micro disc is the mean optic disc size minus 2 standard deviation, and macro disc is the mean optic disc size plus 2 standard deviation. However, only approximately 2.3% fall beyond these limits. Measurement of the optic disc. The ideal method of measurement of optic disc is with the use of slit lamp biomicroscopy with indirect slit lamp lens, in which we use a very thin beam of light about 1.5 to 2 mm width in a retroillumination technique, and it is important to gain the stereoscopic view. And red-free illumination may help in the assessment of the retinal nerve fiber layer. There are various correction factors according to the magnification power of the lens. For example, the 1.3 is for the 90 diopter lens, 1.1 is for the 78 diopter lens, 1 is for 60 diopter lens, and 1.27 for the 3 mirror Goldman lens. Another measurement of the optic disc is with the help of direct ophthalmoscope known as Welch-Eldin ophthalmoscope, which projects a 5 degree circular spot of white light, and it helps to compare the optic disc and the spot. For example, in the first image, the optic disc is larger than the white spot. Therefore, this is a larger optic disc. Second, it is somewhat similar. This is known as a normal or average size optic disc. And third one is the smaller optic disc.
So what is the advantage of slit lamp biomicroscopy with 90D examination as compared to direct ophthalmoscope? Main advantage.
First of all, the stereoscopic view is more easily with 90 diopter lens.
Yes, you get a stereoscopic view, while with direct you won't get that. And what about indirect ophthalmoscope?
I mean, indirect ophthalmoscope, we won't able to identify the minute details with the because
yes,
it shows.
It is a stereoscopic view. The image magnification is less. That's why stereo using a slit lamp biomicroscopy with 90 D is the ideal way to examine
ideal.
That.
Yes, ma'am. This is our in-house publication, which tells about the optic disc dimension and cup disc ratio, in which a total of 623 healthy phakic participants of Chennai glaucoma were underwent a complete eye examination. The study concluded that the mean optic disc area is 2.82 plus minus 0.52 millimeter square. The mean cup area is 0.53 plus minus 0.39 millimeter square. The mean CDR ratio was 0.36 plus minus 18. The study also concluded that men had a larger optic disc as compared to the women, and cup area and vertical CDR ratio revealed significant association with disc area. Even pathologically, it is important because certain diseases such as optic nerve head drusen, non-arthritic anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, pseudopapillary edema and hyperopia having small optic disc, while high myopia, optic nerve pit and morning glory syndrome have a large optic disc. Elsen scleral rim. Elsen scleral rim is a white rim surrounding the optic disc. It is actually the anterior.
Can anyone tell me what is the difference between the small optic disc and large optic disc for the overall morphology? Anyone from the first year? Any second year person? Smaller disc and large disc, what will be the difference?
Yes, ma'am. In smaller disc, we tend to underestimate the cup disc ratio. In cases of a larger disc, the axonal fibers also increase, but they're not in proportion to the increase of the disc size. So we tend to overestimate the cup disc ratio. And
before you go for overestimation and underestimation, what is the basic difference? In the larger disc, they will have large cup. While small disc, they will have a small cup, including the nerve fiber here. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So, and rim area will also be bigger in the. Even if the disc looks small, they will have a smaller rim area in the small disc. Okay. Small disc is more like a crowded disc. That's why it is more prone for development of compartment-like syndrome. While in large disc, why it is more prone for glaucomatous damage? Any third year person? What is the problem with large disc?
Ma'am, the nerve fibers passing through a single pore or more, so the pore size is basically larger, and the intervening connective tissue is thinner or less in case of larger disc. So the stability of the lamina cribrosa is not so strong. So there is easy posterior bowing of lamina cribrosa even with mild fluctuations of height.
Yes. There is a less structural support, particularly at the pole, so that's why they are more susceptible. Okay, you can carry on, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Then we come to the Elsen scleral ring. Elsen scleral ring is a white ring surrounding the optic disc. It is the anterior extension of the sclera between the choroid and the optic nerve head. The most important point to note here is that the one should not include while measuring the optic disc diameter. Then we come to the optic disc shape. The normal optic disc is vertically oval form with vertical diameter being about 7 to 10% larger than the horizontal diameter. Then the optic cup. The optic cup is a central pale portion of the optic disc. The pale color is due to the absence of the neuroretinal rim and the exposure of the underlying lamina cribrosa. The shape of the optic cup is horizontally oval. It helps to get the ratio of the cup diameter to the disc diameter, and it depends upon the disc of the size of the disc. The smaller disc shows smaller cup and larger disc have large cup. Normally, the horizontal cup disc ratio is larger than the vertical cup disc ratio, but in glaucoma, due to the preferential loss of axons in the either of the poles, there is a vertical enlargement due to which the vertical cup disc diameter ratio increases faster than the horizontal one. When there is a continuous deepening of the cup, which causes the exposure of the underlying lamina cribrosa, is often recognized as a gray fenestra of the lamina, seen as a gray dots. This is referred to as lamina dot sign. Then we come to the neuroretinal rim. The neuroretinal rim is the intrapapillary extension of the nerve fiber layer. It is the width between the outer edge of the disc and the inner edge of the rim where the actual blood vessel bend. The famous ISNT rule, which was termed by the Warner, says that the inferior is the broadest, followed by the superior, followed by the nasal, and then the temporal. This is due to the combination of the vertical diameter of the disc and the larger horizontal diameter of the cup, due to which the poles are having the broader area as compared to the nasal and temporal. The loss of tissue from the inner edge of the rim forms a cardinal sign of glaucomatous optic neuropathy. Neuroretinal rim size reduces in glaucoma. The size reduction can either be localized or diffuse. This reduction is actually the loss of axons. Then we come to the pallor of the rim, the color of the rim. I mean, pallor is a typical sign of optic nerve head damage, though it is not specific for glaucoma. If NRR looks rather pale, the possibility of non-glaucomatous optic neuropathy is higher than the glaucoma. For early diagnosis of glaucoma, the inferotemporal and superotemporal disc sector should be especially be checked for glaucomatous changes. Coming to the localized loss, the focal atrophy of the neural rim often begin as a small discrete defect, which has been referred to as polar notching, focal notching, or pit-like changes. Here we can see the inferior notch in both the images, and along with the retinal nerve fiber layer defect, which we'll be talking in the subsequent slide. This slide shows about the variation in the neuroretinal rim thinning. The first picture shows that the neuroretinal rim is not following the ISNT rule, and there is a superior rim thinning. Then the second picture shows that there is in the superotemporal aspect, there is a focal notch present. And in the third picture, there is a circumferential rim loss to a certain extent causing the rim loss. According to the Hale, the notch is defined as focal reduction in the neural rim width less than 4 clock hours. Coming to the diffuse loss, in some cases, the loss of neural rim tissue usually begins temporally and then progresses circumferentially toward this pole, resulting in the enlargement of the cup in concentric shape, as is seen in this picture. Coming to the color, the normal neuroretinal rim color is orange-pink in color because of the associated capillaries between the cup margin and the disc margin. But when the cupping is more than pallor, it points towards the glaucomatous pathology, while if pallor is more than cupping, the non-glaucomatous pathology is more common than glaucomatous one. This picture shows the optic disc between the difference between the healthy and glaucomatous optic disc in terms of neuroretinal rim. In the first picture, we can able to appreciate that the neuroretinal rim is healthy and pink in color following the ISNT rule. However, in the second image, we can appreciate that the neuroretinal rim is thinned out and paled, and even the ISNT rule is not followed. Coming to the cup disc ratio, it is the vertical diameter of the cup to the vertical diameter of the disc. As I already discussed, for the diameter of the optic disc, scleral ring should be kept in mind. To define the margin of the cup, there are two main indicators. First, we should see the sharp drop where the NRR ends and the cup margin starts. And the second, the direction or point of deviation of small blood vessel on the surface of optic nerve head. As in this picture, we can appreciate this, the deviation of the small blood vessel, which helps to demarcate the cup margin. The normal cup disc ratio varies between 0.1 to 0.4. However, 5% may have 0.7:1. Cup disc ratios. This shows the various cup disc ratios. The first image in which we are not able to appreciate any cup, so it is 0.0:1. In the second image, with the help of the blood vessel, we are able to demarcate the cup margin as 0.4:1. In the third image, it is approximately 0.6:1. And in the fourth image, it is 0.8:1. There are two terms, contour cupping and color cupping. In the evaluation of the glaucomatous disc damage, it is the contour cup that is of relevance and not the color cup. There is a normal tendency to estimate the cup margin with central pale color, and this should not be done, and we should mainly see the bending of the blood vessel where the actual cup margin ends. Like in this picture, we are able to identify that the blue arrow marks the central pale cup, while the green arrow marks the actual bending of the vessel where the cup margin ends. This is also one of the in-house publications which states that with increasing disc size, the mean vertical CDR ratio also increases. Coming to the asymmetry of the optic disc, the disc asymmetry between the two eye can be asymmetry in the size of the cup, width of the NRR, vessel course, and pericapillary atrophy. Asymmetry of the cup disc ratio more than 0.2 occurring less than 1% of normal individual, and that greatly increases the suspicions of glaucoma. Like in this picture, the first image which shows the cup disc ratio, this is a cup disc ratio asymmetry in which the first image shows the cup disc ratio of approximately 0.7, while the second image shows the cup disc ratio with the help of this bending of vessel, we can tell that it is 0.4, 0.3. So there is a cup disc ratio asymmetry. However, it is not always the cup disc ratio asymmetry. In some patient, there might be a disc size asymmetry. Like in this image, here we can see that the disc size is almost normal average size, while in this image, there is a moderately enlarged size, which is confirmed with the help of Heidelberg retinal tomography. Coming to the retinal nerve fiber layer changes, it is best seen under red-free light. It can be either localized loss or diffuse loss. Localized loss are normally wedge shape which reaches towards the margin, and it signifies no optic disc disease. However, it is more common in the inferotemporal aspect more than superotemporal. And in diffuse loss, there is increased visibility of the retinal blood vessel. Coming to the healthy retinal nerve fiber layer, this appears as a normal white striations, more commonly at the superior and inferior aspect of the optic disc. These are actually the light reflected from the bundles. The wedge-shaped RNFL defect. In this image, we can appreciate there is a superotemporal wedge-shaped RNFL defect in both the images, which is more commonly appreciable in the red-free filter. However, in the inferior aspect, inferotemporal aspect, we can see the white striation, which represent the normal RNFL layers. This wedge-shaped RNFL defect should be distinguished with the slit-shaped RNFL defect, also known as pseudo defect. Here we can able to appreciate, which is more commonly in the red-free filter. This slit-shaped defect are normally narrower than the blood vessel, and this does not reaches the disc margin. Here again we can able to see that there is a wedge-shaped defect in the inferotemporal aspect, along with the focal notch, which is easily appreciable in the red-free filter, and it corresponds to the superonasal defect in the visual fields. Coming to the vascular changes, these are the vascular changes we will be seeing. The first is the disc hemorrhage. Disc hemorrhage are also called as splinter. Disc hemorrhage are splinter-like or flame-shaped, also known as Drenz hemorrhage, which is more particularly seen at the border of the optic nerve head. It is detected in about 4 to 7% of eye with glaucoma. Though it is not pathognomic of glaucoma, but it is of significant finding because sometimes it may be the first sign of the glaucomatous damage. It is usually located in the inferotemporal or superotemporal disc region, and it is associated with localized retinal nerve fiber layer defect, neuroretinal rim notch, and corresponding field defect. In all such cases, a stereoscopic disc photograph for documentation is important for further comparison and to see the progression. Here we can see that there is a disc hemorrhage over the nasal side and inferotemporal aspect. Bayonetting sign. When the retinal vessel crosses the sharpened rim, it will bend sharply at the edge of the disc, creating the bayonetting at the disc. Here we can see the inferior aspect, there's a bayonetting sign. Then there's a nasalization of the vessel. It is seen in the advanced glaucomatous disc where the central trunk is shifted towards the nasal side. Though it is not considered as a specific for glaucoma. Then coming to the bearing of circumlinear vessel, normally one or two vessel outlines the cup margin, but due to the elongation of the cup, these vessels are bared from the cup margin, and this is known as bearing of the circumlinear vessels, and we can see the gap between the cup margin and the vessel. These are called as bearing of vessels. And last is the vascular loop. It is also seen in the advanced glaucomatous damage, and it may represent the loops of collateral vessels in response to chronic ischemia. Coming to the peri and parapapillary chorioretinal atrophy, the peripapillary, it is also known as peripapillary ring of Elching. There are two zones, alpha zone and beta zone. The alpha zone is more peripheral, and it is a hypo, and it represents the hypo and hyperpigmentation of retinal pigment epithelium, and along with the thinning of chorioretinal tissue layer. While the beta zone, there is an atrophy of the retinal pigment epithelium and choriocapillary, due to which there is a visible sclera in the choroidal vessel. In normal eye, it is most commonly seen on the temporal, inferior, and superior aspect, and rarely on the nasal side. In this image, we can see that the black arrow represents the scleral ring, L-cell scleral ring. The white arrow is the beta zone, which is closer to the optic disc, and the dark blue arrow is the alpha zone, which is more peripheral to the optic disc. The alpha zone is present almost in all normal eye. However, the beta zone is seen only in 20% of healthy eyes, and it is more common in glaucomatous eye. Beta zone is independently associated with severe glaucomatous optic neuropathy, and it is also associated with rapid visual field progression and RNFL thinning. However, the beta zone alone is not sufficient to differentiate glaucoma. Fundus camera. The disc photograph we usually take with the help of fundus camera. In our institute, we use Zeiss FF450 plus fundus camera with VisuPac digital imaging. The red circle marks the knob which is present, which help us to take the photo in different degrees. The photography include a stereo pair of 20 degree for optic disc and 30 degree for RNFL, for red free filter for RNFL assessment.
So 1 minute, can anyone tell me what is the advantage of the disc photograph over the other imaging technology? Which there is something which photograph can pick up but not the imaging. What else you can pick up on the photographs?
Some sequential photographs can pick up the changes occurring over time.
What changes? There are, one she already told, disc hemorrhage. What is,
Focal thinning or thinning of RNFL.
And that focal will tell you, but it's specific to disc photograph.
Ma'am, actually.
What about the disc pallor? Can imaging will pick up the pallor?
No, ma'am. Imaging won't able to pick up the pallor.
That is very important. And the advantage of disc photography is very cheap, and you can compare over the period of years. No, technological update, how you have HRT1, HRT2, HRT3, this photograph from 1980s also can be compared in 2020 also. That is the main advantage, okay?
The Jonas et al. Describe the three types of cupping. In the first image, we are not able to identify the cup, so it is no cupping. Other is a well-demarcated cup with steep side in the second image, while the third with the cups with temporal flat slope. This slide shows the difference, different sloping. In the first image, there is an incomplete inferior slope, while in the second image, there is a diffuse sloping, and in the third image, there is a temporal complete sloping. And coming to the types of optic disc in glaucoma, there are.
Sorry, can you go back to the last slide?
Yes, ma'am.
What is that arrow pointing? Middle image, diffuse sloping.
Ma'am, the arrow points towards the extent of the cup margin. We can demarcate with the help of bending of the vessels.
So that you need to highlight, that bending of the vessel will give you the clue. Okay.
Yes. Types of the optic disc in glaucoma. There are four types of optic disc. The first is a focal glaucomatous optic disc. As the name says, there's a localized neuroretinal rim tissue loss, primarily at the either of the poles. The poles are affected because they have a large pores in the lamina cribrosa and thinner connective tissue and large number of axons. Here we can see that in the superior aspect, there is a focal notch along with the retinal nerve fiber layer defect. A second is a myopic glaucomatous optic disc, in which the disc is mostly tilted and obliquely implanted with a shallow cup appearance. And even there is a myopic temporal crescent of peripapillary atrophy, shows additional evidence of glaucomatous damage, usually in the form of thinning of the superior and inferior neuroretinal rim in the absence of degenerative myopia. In this image, we can appreciate that the optic disc is tilted with the neuroretinal rim being almost thinned out with a cup disc ratio of 0.9, and even there is a peripapillary atrophy at the inferior aspect. Coming to the third type, which is a senile sclerotic optic disc, in which there is a diffuse neuroretinal rim tissue loss, and there is a presence of saucerization. Saucerization is a gentle sloping of the cup margin, and there is also complete ring of peripapillary atrophy and choroidal sclerosis, also known as fundus tessellation. And the fourth and the last one is a generalized enlargement of the optic disc cup, in which the cup is uniformly enlarged and round, and there are no localized area of neuroretinal rim tissue loss. These are the image of the tilted optic disc, which sometimes make it difficult to diagnose the glaucoma insert disc. Like in first image, we can able to appreciate the cup margin. However, in the second image, we are not able to see the cup margin. So it is very difficult to identify, to diagnose the glaucoma in such cases. This recording is very important to see the progression and even for the future comparison. Like in this case, we have drawn in here, we can see that we should draw the optic disc, which is quite large, with a vertical CDR ratio should be mentioned. Even if there is any inferior rim excavation or notch has present over here should be drawn, and even the RNFL defect, if any, should be kept in mind. And we can see that there are two hemorrhages present over the nasal aspect, and the inferotemporal aspect should also be drawn. Coming to the CDR ratio again, these are the four discs with the first three discs are normal average size. However, the fourth disc is a moderately large size. In the first three discs, we can appreciate the CDR ratio of 0.4. But when we see to the disc B, it seems to be normal. However, the disc A and C is not normal. So the CDR ratio is not a good parameter. So due to which the Spieth and his colleague came up with the disc damage likelihood scale. He introduced the rim disc ratio into the clinical grading of glaucoma. And the system categorized the disc as small, medium, or large. The DDLS is based on the radial width of the NRR measured at one axis compared to the diameter of the disc in the same axis. Here we can see if the rim is totally lost, then we should see the circumferential extent of the rim loss in the terms of degree. For smaller disc, the DDLS stage should be increased by 1. However, for large disc, the DDLS stage should be decreased by 1.
Yes, ma'am. Can any fellow please tell me what is the limitations for this disc damage likelihood scale?
Ma'am, the limitations for this is that one is on the optic disc size is different. So for different individuals.
Consider the optic disc size.
And ma'am, it doesn't keep into account the extent of the visual field damage, ma'am.
Basically, they have
told
that this damage, like you said, we do not take into account where the loss is. Okay, that is the first thing. It cannot be applied for the tilted disc or morphologically abnormal disc like optic disc coloboma. And if there is a very non-contagious minimal thinning, then that can also be underestimated. Okay.
These are the various suggestive signs of glaucomatous nerve damage. The highly suggestive signs are the asymmetry between the two eye of the disc and the localized hemorrhage crossing the rim. While the notching, if present, it is very suggestive. And the definite signs are the enlargement of the cup associated with thinning of the rim and acquired pit of the optic nerve. Then we come to the sequential evaluation of the optic disc. It is also very important to note that the neuroretinal rim size and shape, retinal nerve fiber layer, presence of peripapillary atrophy, and the presence of retinal or optic disc hemorrhage. And there should be at least one optic disc photograph per year should be performed in glaucoma suspect to detect any structural changes. Like in this diagram, the first row indicates that there is a vertical elongation of the optic cup with a superior and inferior rim thinning. While in the second row, though there is a vertical elongation of the optic cup, the superior rim seems to be normal. However, there is a complete loss of the inferior rim, creating a focal notch. This is images of a patient diagnosed with glaucoma in which he was followed for a period of years, where we can see in the 2012, it is a normal size optic disc, though the NRR is not following the ISNT rule. Here we can see that there is a superior rim thinning associated with the focal notch, and which is persistent throughout the follow-up period, and it is even evident with the help of visual fields. However, in the second case, such as in this fellow, in 2012, though the optic disc was normal initially, in 2015 he developed the disc hemorrhage in the inferotemporal aspect, and along with the focal notch and RNFL defect superotemporally. In 2020, again the disc hemorrhage disappeared, but the focal notch and the RNFL defect persisted. Which can be evident with the help of visual fields, in which initially in 2012 there was only the inferonasal aspect was affected. However, while reaching the 2020, he started developing the inferior arcuate scotoma. Whenever we see the optic disc, for diagnosis of glaucoma, there should be a certain congenital anomalies of the optic disc should be kept in mind that can simulate the glaucoma, like a morning glory syndrome or optic disc coloboma. Though the prevalence of the optic disc anomalies is 1.1% in adult South Indian population. This was also an in-house publication.
Before revise, is there any other non-glaucomatous cause for optic disc cupping?
Ma'am, in case of neuro-ophthal conditions, there can be pallor associated with cupping, but pallor more than cupping.
What neuro-ophthalmological
conditions? Ma'am, when there is optic atrophy setting in.
Ma'am, non-arthritic ectopic ischemic optic neuropathy.
What is? It can be compressive optic neuropathy, or you can have in lethal alcohol poisoning also. But how you will differentiate? Dr. Komal, can you tell us how you will differentiate?
Ma'am, with other signs like RNFL defect.
Ma'am, optic nerve hypoplasia. There's a gray line and the distance between optic nerve and fovea is...
We are going totally in different direction. What I have asked is how you will differentiate between the glaucomatous and non-glaucomatous cupping. There will be certain specific signs or findings in non-glaucomatous cupping.
Ma'am, in glaucomatous cupping, the Eason rule won't be followed. There will be associated RNFL defect. We can have associated history of chronic use of steroid or family history of glaucoma can be present in the patient.
No, the most important thing he has already highlighted in earlier slide. What will be more there?
Ma'am, there will be more pallor than cupping.
Yes, very good. Yes,
ma'am, color vision won't be affected in glaucomatous, ma'am.
So you will, there will be significant vision will be affected more significantly than as compared to glaucoma. Glaucoma, the central vision is maintained quite in advantage also. Okay. Then again, the pupillary sign also you will consider. What else you will consider?
RPD will be in
non-glaucomatous. Pupillary changes.
Okay.
They are present in glaucomatous.
Okay, the progression will be more rapid in neurological cases. Okay, particularly the ischemic etiology. Okay. And you will have other signs also. If it is especially the compressive lesion, you will have other systemic signs also.
We have also the vertical meridian will be maintained more in neuro.
The visual field effect will be respecting to vertical meridian in neurological now.
Neuro.
Okay, so we can carry on. Can anyone comment on this disc? How you will comment on this?
Yes, ma'am. It is color fundus photo. First photo is the colored photo, disc photo of right eye where the media is clear. The disc is moderate size. Cup disc ratio is around 0.6. The inferior rim and the superior rim looks equal, and there is no associated peripapillary atrophy.
So what, whenever you are commenting on the disc, what point you will comment on? Can you summarize in short for others?
Yes, ma'am. We have to first comment on the media clarity, then the size of disc, because with that respect we have to tell the cup disc ratio. If the disc is moderate size, small size, or it is a little large, we have to comment about the rims, inferior rim, superior rim, all the four rims. Then we have to comment about the papillary atrophy, alpha zone, beta zone, and associated RNFL defect on red free filter.
So you have to follow the 5R. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what do you think is glaucomatous, non-glaucomatous?
It's a large cup in a large disc, because the healthy, the neuroretinal rim looks healthy.
So this is non-glaucomatous, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Can you So field test was normal. So it's a physiological cupping where only cup is large, but rim is intact. No RNFL defect. No disc in no peripapillary changes. Okay.
Yes.
Ma'am, this is a disc photograph showing a healthy disc, and ma'am, the cup disc ratio looks to be 0.8, and there is a ma'am, there is no peripapillary atrophy or any RNFL defect. Ma'am, the neuroretinal rim looks healthy. It's just a large cup.
Neuroretinal rim.
It might be because of the large cup, but there is no focal thinning of NRR. According to me.
Okay, Dr. Usso, can you comment on this disc?
It is a moderate sized disc with a Kubrick ratio of 0.7:1, showing inferior rim thinning, merely inferior rim loss, with both beta peripapillary atrophy and alpha zone of peripapillary atrophy, and with an inferior inferior temporal RNFL defect also.
Very good. So this is glaucoma, right? So this is just to highlight the changes. Okay, next image. Do you think this is glaucomatous?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, this is a moderate-sized disc with a normal shape. The media clarity is normal. And neuroretinal rim appears healthy throughout, ma'am. There, the cup-to-disc ratio is about, I think it's 0.4:1, with more pallor than cupping, which I can see, ma'am.
Anyone else want to volunteer? Do you think this is a healthy disc?
Ma'am, inferior rim.
Yeah, RNFL defect.
Inferior temporal RNF.
RNFL defect, inferior
RNFL defect.
So, even if this is small and cup is not very large, do not miss the glaucoma. It's a can you show this? Yes. So, this arrow is highlighting the notch and there is a defect also. So, even if cup is small, you have to concentrate on the neuroretinal rim. Okay. Next.
And this is also an example where the color contour and the cup contour are not matching. You can see, if you follow
match.
The
vessel, yes.
You see that the main vessel is actually emerging close to the rim. At a glance, it is fooling you like a 0.4 cup, but actually this is different.
This is very obvious. Anyone can help. Who will volunteer for this one? This is the easiest one.
It is a moderate size disc.
I mean, you are only answering. I want to
volunteer. The cup disc ratio appears to be around 0.8:1. There is temporal thinning of the neuroretinal rim, and inferior and superior neuroretinal rim are also thinned out, ma'am. And this pallor of the disc.
First, you always have to start with the disc size. Do you think it is 0.8? Can you see the superior and inferior rim? Can you make out? It's almost the glaucomatous optic atrophy, very advanced. Okay. Next slide.
Ma'am, this is a moderate size disc with a 0.5:1 cup disc ratio. Ma'am, the neuroretinal rim looks healthy.
I mean, inferiorly branch hemorrhage is there.
Branch hemorrhage is there. Yes. What else? You can see the inferior rim carefully.
Ma'am, RNFL
defect. Apart from that, I have rim, I'm saying.
Sphincter hemorrhage.
Yes, everyone told the sphincter hemorrhage, but can you make out the neuroretinal rim? There is small blood vessel, you can see it is dipping downward. Can you make out?
Inferior rim notches.
Yes. Usta, can you show that? See, there is a focal dipping of the blood vessels. Okay, so there is basically very early not an RNFL defect. If you just see it, in a short time, you might feel this disc is normal, but you have to look very carefully, okay? So, this is glaucoma or not glaucomatous?
Yes, ma'am, it's glaucomatous disc.
Dr. Usav, do you want to comment on this image?
This is the optic, this is a color fundus photography of optic disc, which shows the, which is a normal, moderately at large optic disc. And there is also the media is clear with a cup disc ratio of about 0.6:1, and there is also a focal notch present over the, not actual focal notch, but there is also the retinal nerve fiber layer defect at the superotemporal aspect.
There is a peripapillary atrophy. Can you look out?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Peripapillary atrophy. Superior pole, and that is clearly. If you look very carefully, there is small where there is a RNFL defect. Can you see the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
That arrow. Can you go to last slide? See, there you can see the vessel bending. Okay, so that should be your clue. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
One more thing, if you see the.
big blood vessel in the RNFL, no, is much more redder than the corresponding vessel of the infratemporal arcade.
Yes, ma'am.
Earlier when you said that you have, when you have diffuse loss, the blood vessels become more prominent. This is
prominent.
What feature, because the retinal blood vessels are within the superficial retinal nerve fiber layer. So when you have a diffuse loss of the retinal nerve fiber layer, the blood vessels tend to stand out. So you can see that there is definitely the superior main trunk looks redder than the inferior main trunk. So when you have diffuse RNFL loss, this is how it looks. Because this blood vessel is within that broad area of RNFL, you are able to appreciate the difference.
These are my references, and thank you Dr. TSP ma'am for guiding and moderating, and thank you all of you for being a patient listener. Thank you all.
Thank you.